Dear colleagues, hi everyone, and welcome to Turkey and the capital city Ankara. I hope you like here. And I want to talk about partial rotator cuff tears. Firstly, I will talk about the classification, and then we will shortly talk about type of tears, etiology, and treatment methods. And lastly, I will talk about surgical techniques and the results. For the classification, we usually use the Ellman classification system, as you know. These are divided into articular surface, bursal surface, and interstitial tears. And according to the depth, we see as grade 1, grade 2, and grade 3. Types of the tears are bursal size tears, articular size tears, as I told, and intertendinous tears. We divided the şeyler kaymış herhalde bir miktar. We divided the articular size partial tears into capsular tears, reverse flap capsular tears, and pasta lesions. If the tear of the size is more than 50%, we describe it as pasta lesion, and it mostly requires the surgical treatment. And in a clinical study that was done in our clinic with the lead of Dr. Kanatlı, we investigated 50 patients with isolated bursal size tears, and control group was isolated slab tears with no partial rotator cuff tears. And superior capsule tears was classical capsular, reverse flap, and diffuse synovitis. And according to the results, there was a significant positive correlation in the presence of both synovitis and reverse flap capsule tears. But no significant difference was found between the presence of classical capsular tear and the presence of bursal side tears. So, reverse flap capsule tears and synovitis was associated with partial bursal side tears. However, if the reverse flap capsule tear or synovitis is detected in the superior capsule, the rotator cuff should be evaluated not to miss a bursal side tear. And if we want to talk about etiology, is divided into two groups. This is intrinsic and extrinsic, as you know. And intrinsic is mostly degenerative tears resulting from aging-related. And extrinsic, now, as you know, external impingement and internal impingement, and mostly glenohumeral instability, acute trauma, or repeating microtrauma. In a clinical study, 96 isolated partial supraspinatus tear was evaluated with the failed conservative treatment and persistent shoulder pain, and which was in Ellman grade 3. And tear type was bursal and articular sided, and we concluded we tried to find if there is a cortical ligament degenerated as a predictive factor for impingement syndrome or type of rotator cuff partial ruptures. And with the coracoacromial ligament degeneration, we found a strong predictive impingement syndrome for the bursal side partial tendon tears. And so if we see a coracoacromial ligament degeneration, we have to be aware for the bursal side partial rotator cuff injuries. And if we see a coracoacromial ligament degeneration, it can guide surgeon to release ligament and debridement or acromioplasty for degeneration and success of the surgery. Physiologically, during abduction and external rotation, there is contact between the supraspinatus and infraspinatus articular surfaces and posterior superior of the glenoid. This is physiological, but if some pain and lack of movement is addition, we can talk about some pathologic. Accompanying articular surface and partial rotator cuff tear and slab should be not avoided in the treatment of rotator cuff surgery. And For the etiology, we have to think about always glenoid retroversion, posterior capsular contractor, or scapular dyskinesia, because if we miss that, the success of the surgical treatment would be not as good as we wanted. In a clinical study, 87 University baseball player was evaluated with ultrasonography, and 48 was articular-sided partial tears. And according to the results, articular-sided partial thickness rotator cuff tear by itself didn't cause shoulder pain or muscle weakness, and may not be pathological tendon tear. And when a partial tear of the articular surface is detected, the accompanying slap lesion and glenoid retroversion is must also be evaluated. And conservative treatment for the articular surface partial tears would also be insisted for internal impingement syndrome. And success of surgical treatment will be affected if posterior capsular tension and scapular dyskinesia do not treat it first. Let's talk about the treatment methods. As you know, the first option for the partial rotator cuff injuries is conservative. As you know, activity modification, some injections, or physiotherapy is firstly we think about when we see partial rotator cuff injuries. And for the arthroscopic treatment, we make some debridements, institute repair, and repair after converted to full thickness tear. And after six, in a clinical study with 272 patients, and the failure of the most partial rotator cuff injuries was related with the bursal side tears and dominant extremity side tears, or over 50% depth of the tear. And in a, again, in a clinical study that we have done in our clinic, and with 201 patients with isolated partial rotator cuff teared with palliative conservative management was evaluated. And conservative, in our opinion, conservative treatment should be the first option, but should not be insisted for patients with severe pain or bursal side tears with a depth of over 50%. Arthroscopic debridement is the first option for the partial rotator cuff injuries, tears. This is the subacromial space. And by the cannula, we debride it after for the grade 1 injuries or for the tears under 5 millimeter with RF debridement, and then we see the bare area, the footprint, and if it is not consistent with the capsule over 6 millimeter, we use just debridement for the injuries with arthroscopic debridement. For the bursal side injuries, we usually use debridement of degenerative bursal portion, and then if it is more than 50% or if it is over than 6 millimeter from the articular cartilage, we use modified lateral tension band repair. We apply two sutures, one from anterior and one from posterior. And then we take it to the subacromial space. You will see a detailed information and during the live surgeries. Intratendinosus tears are rarely we can see, but With the bubble sign, we can in the MRI, we can see, as you see, there is an intertendinous tear. And after debridement, we see a Bayer area, and we convert it to the full thickness tears, and then make the repair. For the articular sided tears, the first attachment is the capsule of the articular side, and it is about 5 or 6 millimeters. If there's a capsule tear, firstly we try to evaluate it if it is more than 6 millimeter or not, and if it is just lower than 6 millimeter, we just debride it. But for the over than 50% involvement, we call it as pasta lesions. We make the repair by making it to the full thickness tendon repair. And this is the posterior loop, and this is the anterior loop. You see it from the subacromial spaces. We are tying the tears. For the long term of patients, for the long term outcomes after in situ arthroscopic repair of partial rotator cuff injuries, and most of the patients are returned to sport according to this study. And in a clinical study that was again with Dr. Kanitla and colleagues, and arthroscopic repair was done for the bursal sided and intratendinous tears. Repair without transforming to full thickness. For the articular sided tears, we repaired with transforming to full thickness. For the grade 3 partial rotator cuff tears, revealed satisfactory outcomes regardless of the type of the tear. And this is the treatment of methods of partial rotator cuff injuries. You can see it in our new book that we prepared for you. And when we see partial thickness rotator cuff tears, pain, we see the patients with pain, functional deficit, weakness, and also night pain. Firstly, we decided to make conservative treatment for 3 or 6 months. As you know, non-steroid exercise, physical therapy, and activity modification. And if we failed about conservative treatments that are mostly with bursal sided tears or the tear with over the depth of 50%, and we decided to do the surgery. If size of the tear is lower than 50%, first option is debridement. And if you see an intrinsic impingement, we add the acromioplasty. That was for bursal sided tears because that is mostly related with the impingement, subacromial impingement syndrome. And if the size of the tear is more than 50%, first we complete it and repair with after converting it to full thickness, and by adding acromioplasty or not, it depends on you and the patient. And in the second option, we use in situ repair for bursal sided tears. And you also may add acromioplasty or not. And the third option is transtendinous repair. And thanks for listening.